Well, good evening, and I'm really delighted to be here. I've been here now 4 days, been having a wonderful time, so I have a great deal of gratitude to express. First of all, to all of you, actually, because I think I'm the reason why you all have to speak English to each other tonight. So you are showing great kindness to a handicapped person who appreciates it very much. I also want to thank Eloisa for the very unexpected invitation to come here. We were talking about why it is that I'm here to talk at this particular festival just before the evening events began, and Eloisa reminded me that she invited me last year when the topic of the Ultima Academy was music and politics, and particularly nationalist politics. For that, I am a natural candidate, so I understand why I was invited. But I had to decline last year. And I said that it's a bad time for those of us who are in, you know, the academic profession, beginning of a school term and so on. But I said, next year I'll be retired, I'll be a man of leisure, I'll be a free bird. Why don't you invite me then? So yes, sure enough, I got an invitation. And she said, this year the topic is nature. And I said, I'm a city boy. But she said, well, we're doing a performance of Turangalîla, and maybe you can find some connection. So I thought of what Eloise already said I'm going to speak about. If you know my work, you might be surprised that I'm speaking about this. Ian Pace, the pianist who was here for a concert a couple of days ago, was surprised. We were having lunch, and he said, you know, I never thought of you as a Messiaen person. Actually, neither had I. But, you know, offered a trip to Oslo with Turangalîla thrown in, I can be a Messiaen person. So I'm very grateful that that invitation stood. And I really had a great time getting ready for this, learning a lot of things that I hadn't known and putting them together with what I had known. One last thank you is to John Worland, who's going to be assisting me with the video. This is another way in which I'm a handicapped person. The office manager at Berkeley used to say, in his California way, Richard, he used to say, you have the worst machine karma I've ever seen. And so I'm very glad that somebody with better karma is available to make sure that the examples go smoothly. Messiaen is a very unusual figure in 20th century music. And when I wrote the Oxford History of Western Music, I found it was not easy to decide where Messiaen fit in. In fact, in a way, he did not fit in with the music of his time. And the fact that he didn't fit in with the music of his time is the way in which he did fit in with the story that I wanted to tell about him. One of the things I said about him in the chapter in which he appears in my history is that looking at Messiaen and looking at the world in which he was living, the first thing you notice about Messiaen is that he never noticed anything. By which I mean he never paid attention to what was going on in the world around him. And in a very strange sense, but in a way that is very consistent with his world outlook, the 20th century as a time period didn't exist for him. When we think back to the 20th century, those of us who lived most of our lives in it, I'm not talking to you lucky millennials now, but you may have heard of the 20th century. It was a pretty grim century. You know, we think of the 20th century, we think of gulags, we think of holocausts, we think of natural disasters and wars, and we think of the existential despair that all of that brought forth, which became one of the overriding themes of 20th century art. In fact, there were those who thought that unless art was expressing existential despair, that is, unless 20th century art was expressing existential despair, it was not authentic art. You know who I must be thinking of now. The philosopher whose initials are an airline, yeah, TWA, Theodor Wiesengrund and Adorno, whose name I do not like to pronounce. I don't know what he thought about Messiaen, nor do I know what Messiaen thought about Adorno. But I can imagine, and they are probably in neither case printable, because Messiaen was not at all interested in the things that produced the existential despair of the 20th century. He once said, and his widow, Yvonne Loriot, his second wife, quoted him as saying that, "I don't want to waste my time on harrowing subject matter. I have much better things to do." In other words, there are much more important things than the Holocaust. There are much more important things than Gulag. In fact, I'm inspired by the talk that preceded mine tonight to say that anything that had to do with time, Messiaen took no interest in. He was interested only in the alternative world, the world that has no time, that is, the world of the divine. And his entire attention was focused on that. To another interviewer, he once said, "I'm very lucky that I was born Catholic, because this gave me a kind of joy that no one else can know." Catholics think they're very special. But in this way, Messiaen was very special among 20th century composers, because look, he was born in the first decade of the 20th century, and he died in the last decade of the 20th century. So his life spanned the 20th century. He was there from almost the beginning to almost the end. And he got from one end to the other and never let up the smile on his face, the joy in his heart. How did he do it? That eternally cloudless sky that we find in Messiaen. Were you at Turangalîla on Thursday or Friday? You know, an immense piece of music in terms of length, in terms of the size of the orchestra. It is huge, it is weighty, but it gives you such a lift like no other work of its size and specific gravity, you might say. It is a work that expresses nothing but the greatest euphoria, and it communicates that euphoria. And so little 20th century music communicates that euphoria. And in order to be that euphoric in the 20th century, you have to be colossally unobservant. And that's what I called Messiaen in my Oxford history. So, of course, a lot of people who read that adjective thought that I was putting Messiaen down, that I was denigrating him. I was so far from denigrating him. I think of him as one of the truly great composers of the 20th century, but in the most untypical way. Well, one Messiaen scholar tried to set me straight about calling Messiaen unobservant of the world around him. Inevitably, that scholar was a former pupil of mine. That's how it always works, right? They always turn against you. So his name was Robert Fallon, and he wrote a very interesting article in which he tried to show that there were aspects of 20th century history, that is, 20th century temporality, that did impinge on Messiaen's consciousness. By the way, before I get to the example that Robert Fallon brought to my attention, and that I'll bring to yours as a way of getting started into talking about other aspects of Messiaen, maybe it occurred to you that it is a very odd project for a composer of music to represent what is timeless, because music, after all, is a temporal medium. So how do you use a temporal medium to do away with time? Well, that is at the heart of Messiaen's whole compositional technique, which he laid out in very systematic, I would almost say schoolmasterly way, starting in 1944 with the first book he wrote about his own musical style called Le Technique de mon langage musical, The Technique of My Musical Language, in which he contributed some very interesting terms to the vocabulary of music theory. Since this is not really my subject, I just want to very briefly tell you what they were. One of them was a way of organizing pitch around what he called modes of limited transposition, which means a scale, for example, that if you transpose it up a step, the scale stays exactly the same. So there's no change. So you have motion but no change. which is a way of representing, it seems to me, timelessness. There can be events, but nothing happens. So you transpose a whole tone scale by one of its own whole tones, the scale reproduces itself. That's his first mode of limited transposition. There's a scale which, if you transpose it by a minor third, all the same notes come back. That's called the tone-semitone scale, sometimes called the octatonic scale. Messiaen called it mode number two. And he found 9 such modes. He made an exhaustive catalog. Cataloging things became an obsession for him. We'll come back to that whole idea of cataloging when we get finally to the subject today. But he had this very, very systematic way of eliminating time from his music. In terms of durations, in terms of rhythm, he specialized in rhythmic palindromes. He called them non-retrogradable rhythms. In other words, you do them backwards, they're exactly the same as when you do them forwards. So you make a change that accomplishes nothing. You see, just like transposing a mode of limited transposition, you make a change that accomplishes nothing. The music becomes motionless in that sense. So with Messiaen, there's a lot of apparent motion that produces no actual change or of position or of direction. So it seems to me that his entire musical technique was devoted towards eliminating the idea of time from his music, although the music was temporal. So Messiaen was always making things very difficult for himself that way, using a time art to represent timelessness. And we'll see he also made things very difficult for himself when it came to birds. But now, back to Robert Fallon and his example to show that Messiaen was aware of what was happening. In 1950, which was the time of the early Cold War, Messiaen wrote a piece called Pentecost Mass, Messe de la Pentecôte, for organ. He was an organist, you know, he actually worked as a church organist, which again makes him unique among 20th century masters. I don't think there was another one with his reputation who was actually employed as a church organist. His Pentecost Mass is an organ piece, not a vocal piece. And in it, he did what he did in many pieces. He talked about the apocalypse, because the only thing about time that interested him was the end of time. You see, he was just looking forward to that. As in his Quatuor pour la fin de temps, his quartet for the end of time, which he wrote while he was imprisoned in a stalag in a German prisoner of war camp after the French armistice in 1940. Many people think that that's about looking forward to the end of the time that he was serving at the stalag. No, it was the end of all time that was on his mind. It was always on his mind. So this is one of the many times in which Messiaen represented the apocalypse. Let's hear it. This is from the last movement of the Messe de la Pentecôte called the Sortie, which is like the recessional. Can we have that first example, John? Is that the part that, why didn't we have any video? Can you put, get
it's
the,
no video.
That one had no video?
No.
All right. Actually, that was not the passage that I hoped it would be. As you see, machine karma, but there is a very, very heavy loud chord, which uses up all 9 notes of the eighth mode of limited transposition. Very, very loud, very, very dissonant, and I'm sorry you didn't hear it because of the comment I want to make about it, but Messiaen wrote something about that in the preface to the work. He said, this is the apocalypse, of course. This is the signifying the end of time. The chord opens up like an exploding bomb. It has clouded the horizon. Bomb. Cloud. Didn't say mushroom cloud, but the imagery there reminded at least Rob Fallon of the atomic bomb. Would have been a timely thing to think about if Messiaen ever thought about time, because 1950 was the period, you know, between the bombs that were dropped on Japan to end World War II in the Pacific And the Soviet successful experiments with detonating their own atomic bombs. And there was a time of American hegemony with nuclear power. There was a very big peace movement that was at the very, very beginning of the Cold War. Rob Fallon thought that Messiaen was reacting to that, and perhaps he was. I, however, tend to resist the idea because, for one thing, the apocalypse was not a catastrophe the way the atomic bomb was a catastrophe. And for another thing, I'm sorry you didn't hear it, because I wanted to say that you've heard the Turangalîla-Symphony, so if Messiaen wanted to do the atomic bomb, I think he would have done a better job than the chord in this organ piece. That's just my opinion. Whether Messiaen was cognizant of the Cold War or not is not something that I want to decide. I can decide. And actually, the Cold War is going to come up again in this talk. But that's the kind of problem that he sets. Because unless you want to find the Cold War in his apocalyptic bomb, or sorry, his apocalyptic chord, then Messiaen seems not to really be attentive to that either. But there was always one great exception to Messiaen's lack of attention to the world around him, and that, of course, was birds, which are very much a part of the world. And Messiaen was devoted to the to birds, to their song, to using it in his music as an artifact, a natural artifact, which somewhat contradicts, or perhaps only seemingly, but nevertheless needs to be addressed, the potential contradiction between this predilection, almost an obsession with Messiaen, and his general ignoring of the world. Now, the first time Messiaen ever represented a bird in his music was in one of his very earliest pieces. So this goes back to the beginning of his career. Four Preludes for Piano, written in 1928 when Messiaen was still a teenager. One of the earliest pieces of his that was published and is still occasionally performed. I hope we can get the video on this one, yeah? The this is example two, yeah. Right, here we are. That's the bird. Right. I'm sorry to have to keep on interrupting the music after such a little snatch, but I do have a lot of examples in very little time. Now, I don't know whether, oh, could you put the picture back up? I don't know whether you recognize that bird because of ornithology or just because you can make a good guess what bird a Catholic is going to want to represent, but that's the inevitable choice. That is a dove. And the first prelude by Messiaen for piano is called La Colombe. And you can be absolutely sure we're going to come back to doves. But that is just the beginning for Messiaen. Did you also notice, well, there was a bird in the title of the piece, and I suppose we could try to decide in what way the bird is being represented in the piece, but the bird is not being represented in this piece by the actual sound that the bird makes. This is not an example of a bird song piece. So it's like a preliminary example to show that Messiaen was interested in birds before their songs came into his music. The first spotting of a bird song in Messiaen's music, only speculative because it was a commentator who spotted it, Robert Sherlock Johnson, who was an English composer who read a study of Messiaen, spotted the first bird song, he says, in an early orchestral work called L'Ascension, The Ascension, from 1933. So Messiaen then was 22 years old. He was born in December, so that's why I didn't say 20. He might have known that he was born in 1908. Oh, did I say 33? No, he was 24 years old. If you take 08 from 33, you get 25, but not till December. So this is from the second movement, Alleluia serie, Alleluia serene, d'un âme qui désire le ciel. serene alleluia, serene hymn of praise from a soul that desires heaven. Let's have a listen. We have video on this, yeah. So, plausible, you think of birds, you think of trills, you hear trills, you think of birds. But Messiaen didn't say so. This is the commentator who found it. The first time Messiaen actually said he was transcribing a bird song in his music was from an organ piece called the La Nativité du Seigneur, the Lord's Nativity. 1935, the last movement, Dieu parmi nous, God among us, and not in the work itself, but in his treatise, The Technique of My Musical Language, which was written 9 years later in 1944, he said that this movement represents a magnificat, that is again a hymn of praise, alleluiatic praise in bird style. Steel oiseau is what he called this style of his. So let's hear a little of that. I wouldn't have guessed that that was a bird, although YouTube is helping us associated with birds. But Messiaen said that was a bird song. So we have to take his word for it. But it was a bird song that is, at this point, is not being rendered in a particularly naturalistic fashion. I think you'll agree. The first time he actually specified what bird his music was embodying was in the first movement of his quartet for the end of time, called Liturgie de Cristal, Crystal Liturgy. His titles are very often rather surrealistic. But in this piece, you know, the scoring of the piece is for piano, violin, clarinet, and cello. And he actually writes in the preface to the score, rather than in the score itself, that in this movement, the clarinet is Mer Noir, which is like blackbird, and the violin is Rossignol, nightingale. Just to remind you, the first thing you heard was the clarinet, that was the nightingale, and you heard da-da-da-da, and you also heard pa-pa-pa-pa. So keep those two things in mind, because that's always going to be Messiaen's nightingale. Whether that really sounds like a nightingale or not, we'll be able to judge that a little later, but it certainly sounds like Messiaen's nightingale. As we can tell, let's hear a little bit of Turangalîla. There is a wonderful movement, the sixth movement in that 10-movement symphony, called the Jardin du Sommeil de l'Amour, the Garden of Love's Sleep, very evocative title. Don't get sleepy now while listening to it. Music is very, very relaxing, except there's also a nightingale in the piano part.
Thank you.
I wanted to go that far because we heard the other thing that is always part of his nightingale. Dita, dita, dita. All right, so we'll go that far, and now we see a big change in the way Messiaen does birds. Up to this point, the birds have been very stylized, except for that nightingale, where you can always spot the nightingale just because you know Messiaen's nightingale-ish habits. The illustrations have been both stylized and rather subjective, so that you wouldn't necessarily even know that they were bird songs. And Messiaen devotes a little chapter, a little less than a one-page chapter, a very short chapter in his treatise of 1944 on his musical technique, to bird song in his music, of which there wasn't that much at that point. But he quotes what we just heard from the quartet, Turangalîla, he hadn't written yet. And he writes quite explicitly, I'll just quote this from the treatise, "Il est ridicule et vain de copier la nature servilement," he writes. It would be ridiculous and futile to try to copy nature slavishly. So he is saying that it is not my purpose here to reproduce an actual bird song in a recognizable way, because that would be an unworthy task for an artist. And besides, it would be impossible. That's why he says it would be both ridiculous and futile. The reason why it would be futile is because birds don't sing tunes that we can play on our instruments, particularly the fact that in birdsong, the intervals are usually a lot smaller than our smallest interval on a keyboard, which is the semitone. So birds sing what we would call microtonal intervals. That's, you know, just shows that we have no theory for it, because it's just like, you know, our stereotype of a savage, right? How he counts, one, two, three, many. And we have whole tone, semitone, microtone, which can be any size, because once you get below a semitone, who cares? So that's what birds do. Also, notice that he imitated the nightingale in the last example we heard on the piano, which has three strikes against it as far as representing birds. It only can play semitones. A piano can't do a true glissando, that is, slide from pitch to pitch, the way all birds do when they sing. Pianists can fake a glissando, but what they really are doing is playing a fast scale of discrete pitches rather than sliding from pitch to pitch. And on a piano, you cannot make a crescendo on a single sustained tone. I mean, you can try to make your audience think you're doing it, but you can't do it. But birds do it. So the piano is the worst possible instrument to imitate birdsong, and yet it was Messiaen's instrument of choice. He also, of course, used other instruments. We heard the clarinet, we heard the violin. Violin is a much better instrument for birdsong than either the clarinet or the piano, because on a violin you can play microtones. In fact, you hear it all the time on violins. You just call it playing out of tune. And you can play glissandos, and you can play crescendo on a single tone, as well as decrescendo, which you can do on the piano, but you know you can't control it. It just happens. So the violin would be the instrument to use, and yet there's only one famous piece of Messiaen's where he actually uses strings, the most likely instrument to imitate birdsong. Instead, he uses instruments that cannot render birdsong exactly. And at first, he admitted as much. At first, he said, it would be silly to try. Nevertheless, he says, here are some examples of birdsongs from my music. So you should understand, he is as if saying, that these are simply my poetic counterparts to bird songs. But then, in the 1950s, everything changed. The change was signaled by one of his perhaps less important pieces. It's a piece for flute and piano called The Blackbird, Le Mel Noir. which he wrote for a contest. It was what you call a pièce de concours. There are lots of those. Every French composer writes pièces de concours because the conservatory needs them in quantity to award prizes. And so for a prize competition on flute, he wrote a piece that imitates the blackbird. And it does nothing but imitate a blackbird. You probably noticed that in all the pieces up till now, the birds haven't really been the subject of the piece. They've just been part of the scene. The scene is always, except for that La Colombe, which is not a bird song piece, but a piece in some sense about the dove that has great significance in Catholic theology. But otherwise, the birds are in the scene, but not the subject. Here, the bird is the subject, and it goes on for about 6 minutes, and it's a very varied portrayal. And he followed it up with a piece that actually multiplies Le Merle Noir by 38, a piece called Réveil des Oiseaux, or The Awakening of the Birds, in which he purported to reproduce the sound that you hear if you're in the forest at 3 a.m. when the birds begin to awaken at the very, very first suggestion of the sunrise. And what he says he's doing in this piece is telescoping from 3 till about 9 a.m. into 20 minutes. And this is what the birds do over those 6 hours crammed into 20 minutes. Reminiscent of the first movement of Debussy's La Mer, which is called From Dawn Till Noon on the Sea. And Eric Satie sent him a little note saying, I particularly love the part around 10:45, he says. Well, you could say the same to Messiaen. I love that part around 8:40 a.m., where, well, whatever happens. But it's simply the way the birds sound. And it's a piece for piano concertante, again, the worst possible instrument, and a large orchestra with lots of extra percussion to widen the timbral range of the orchestra so as to render all the different colors of birdsong. We heard yesterday about Messiaen's synesthesia. That also played, of course, into his choice of instrumentation. This piece was the biggest fiasco of Messiaen's creative career. He got terrible reviews. In fact, he had to change publishers when this piece was so poorly received. He was being published by Durand, which was the most prestigious French music publisher. They'd published Debussy and Ravel, and they said goodbye to Messiaen as a result of Réveil des Oiseaux. He went to Alphonse Leduc and stayed with them till the end. So it was a sort of a traumatic experience. But it didn't deter him. He went on to write another piece doing the very same thing, illustrating birds and nothing but birds, and claiming now to be doing it naturally or naturalistically. Whereas before, he said that it would be ridiculous and futile to try to copy nature slavishly. For the Réveil des Oiseaux and for his next work, Oiseaux Exotiques, Exotic Birds, also for piano concertant, and now an orchestra of winds only, he wrote in the preface to that score that all of these birds were entendus en forêt et sont parfaitement authentiques, he said. I've actually heard these birds in the forest, and their rendering is perfectly authentic, making a claim which previously he said would be an impossible claim. And it can still be demonstrated that it is an impossible thing to do, even though now he's saying he did it. And he meant what he said, at least if you believe that he said what he believed to his many interviewers. He kept repeating that my bird imitations are not only authentic, but I take great pride in their accuracy. And he even said to one of his interviewers, the one, the most faithful one, his Boswell, Claude Samuel, he said, I'm as much an ornithologist as I am a composer. More so, in fact, he said. Really? It has been often demonstrated that ornithologists can't tell what bird Messiaen is imitating. When you play a Messiaen bird to an ornithologist, he's, oh, that's nice music, but he can't tell you what bird it is. Nevertheless, Messiaen continued to insist that his bird song imitations were authentic and accurate. So let's hear a little bit of Oiseau Exotique, the first piece in which he made this claim explicit, and when he was imitating birds not only by transmitting the shape of their melodies, but he also harmonized the bird songs in a way that we'll hear in a minute more analytically, but we'll hear it now in context. This is the central section of Oiseau Exotique, which is the bird chorus again. sorry. This is the dawn chorus, and even more laden, and not only laden in terms of the number of birds being being imitated at once, but now, whereas in Réveil des Oiseaux, they were all birds that you would have heard in a French forest, now he has birds from India, China, Malaysia, and both of the Americas, as he put it, you know, sort of boastfully, in the preface to the score. Sure, you all heard your favorite bird in there, no matter what it is, because it's there somewhere. And he actually wrote two bird choruses that were even bigger than that. One was in a work that he wrote at the end of the 50s called Chronochromie, which is a pseudo-Greek title that comes from chronos, time, and chroma, color. So time and color, and a lot of birds. And in the next to last section called the Epode, he puts 48 birds together. And for once, he's doing with string instruments, 18 solo strings. So, you know, there's a greater chance of authenticity. But again, when you have 18 instruments playing a total of 48 bird calls, the big jangle of sounds, I think, precludes picking out any one to identify. Mm-hmm. Now, it so happens that starting with Oiseau Exotique, it is possible actually to compare Messiaen's transcription with the actual bird song that he was transcribing, because in that work, he worked in part from commercially issued recordings of bird songs. This is another thing that my former pupil, Rob Fallon, discovered. This was his big discovery, in fact. Messiaen never admitted to doing this. He always claimed that he listened to the birds in situ, you know, in the forest. Later in his career as a bird, I was about to say bird watcher, but no, bird listener, he made tape recordings. That is to say, Yvonne Loriot made the tape recordings. She had to carry the tape recorder behind him on, on his forays into the foray to write down the bird calls. So he would, but you know, this gives you a sense that this was not cynical, the fact that Messiaen was claiming accuracy, because if you look at I've never actually looked at the documents, but I read descriptions of them from those who've looked. At the time of his death, he had 200 notebooks full of very meticulous birdsong transcriptions, totaling about 10,000 pages. And then some of you probably know about the so-called traité, or treatise, that was issued by Loriot and various other disciples of Messiaen, editing his posthumous papers, that is, his unpublished papers, including his classroom materials. Seven huge volumes, two of which are devoted to birdsong. So he spent endless hours working very, very hard on getting the birdsong to its final form that he wanted to use in his compositions, which he claimed to be accurate. The amount of effort that he put into it shows that he really felt that this is what he was doing, it seems to me. But he never admitted that he used recordings of bird songs. Perhaps he didn't want to admit that he was using that kind of mechanical aid rather than being wholly natural, you know, in the forest. But Rob Fallon discovered a set of recordings that was issued by Cornell University, by their ornithologists, of the birds of North America. And you remember, Oiseau Exotique contains bird songs from both Americas, as he puts it. Rob found that in one of the notebooks, all of the birds on these records are listed in the same order, and their names are given in English, which is a language that Messiaen did not speak, or at least did not use. I think he understood English, but he refused to speak it. And so all of this together, I think, is pretty conclusive evidence that Messiaen used these recordings. So we can actually listen, because Rob put up a website. Have you got it up, John? Can you show it? So these are the five bird songs from this record set that we know went into Oiseau Exotique. And on this, so here's the pinnated grouse. If you go forward, if you click forward, you hear the bird. And then if you click backward, you hear Messiaen's version as scored up for Oiseau Exotique. So we go through all five. They're pretty short. So that's the pinnated grouse, and here's Messiaen's pinnated grouse. So you heard that, well, it was a lot slower to start with, but we'll talk about the other things he did in a moment. Can we go on to the next bird? Which is, let's see what it is, the wood thrush. And that's it. And now Messiaen's version. Okay. Next is the lazuli finch. That's it. And Messiaen's version. Okay. These are all labeled, of course, in the score. That's how we know that that's what he's doing. Baltimore Oriole, all right, for you baseball fans. Oh, that was it. Okay, shouldn't have talked, but. All right, let's hear that one again. That one's so short. Baltimore, the Baltimore Oriole one more time. First the bird, then the Messiaen. And now, the one that I find most interesting, the cardinal. Now that last one is a good one to take as our last example to remember when considering the controversy that arose over these works of Messiaen's. that purported to transmit bird call authentically and accurately from nature. One of his, you know, even his friends expressed skepticism about this whole project. One being Alexander Gurr, who was a former pupil who revered Messiaen, as all of his former pupils did. He framed the issue by saying, why is it that birds sound like birds, but Messiaen's birds sound like Messiaen, he said. So think about that for a moment. That's not really so hard to as a question. It is merely an expression of skepticism. Because, you know, Vivaldi's birds sound like Vivaldi, and Beethoven's birds sound like Beethoven, and Wagner's birds sound like Wagner, but they also sound like birds. We know when he's doing a bird. So what he is saying, however, is that Messiaen's artistry supervened over his ornithology, whereas Messiaen actually claimed the opposite. And with the cardinal, you heard a harmonization. I know if you know Messiaen's music at all, you would have known that that was Messiaen when you heard the cardinal, because he's using the chords that you associate with his modes of limited transposition, augmented triads and diminished chords. And particularly, there's one particular harmony that Messiaen loved to use, alternating perfect fourths and augmented fourths. And you can go, you know, one perfect fourth, one augmented fourth, then you can add a perfect fourth, then you can add an augmented fourth. And you can keep on doing this till you have all 12 pitches of the chromatic scale. So you can sample that particular chord in any number of voices. And those are such particularly Messiaen-like chords, you immediately know. Although that's also something that Messiaen has in common with many other composers. So it's not just the chord. It's also his particular habits of scoring and his rhythmic habits. But that's typical Messiaen harmony. It's so prevalent in early 20th century music. You find it in Bartok, and you find it in Schoenberg, and you find it in Stravinsky, three composers who have really very little in common except this chord, which they also have in common with Messiaen. In the Oxford History, I called it the atonal triad, because it reminded me of the way the fourths alternate and the way we have major and minor thirds alternating in major and minor triads. So we have the alternation of perfect and augmented fourths. Obviously, cardinals don't do that in the wild. Messiaen does that all the time. So sure, Messiaen's birds sound like Messiaen, but to say that is just simply a propounded truism. Why wouldn't you expect Messiaen's birds to sound like Messiaen? There were other hostile commentators. An English composer named Trevor Hold wrote a really angry piece about Messiaen's birds, saying how it's a fraud because, you know, you listen to a piece like Oiseau Exotique and you hear one bird being represented on the E-flat clarinet, and another one that's being represented on the piano, and another one that's being represented by the Glockenspiel, and what you're hearing are not three birds, you're hearing an E-flat clarinet, a piano, and a Glockenspiel. Well, sure you are, but you know, it's to deal with people like Trevor Hold, I think, that Ottorino Respighi, you know, in the Pines of Rome, when he wanted to do a nightingale, he actually used a recording of a nightingale so that nobody could say, that's not a nightingale, that's a piano, or something like that, you know. And I'm sure that when he did it, well, I guess when Respighi used the phonograph record, he thought he was being very high tech. That was in, you know, the 1930s. But when he did it, he probably, well, it reminds me anyway of something that Vivaldi was supposed to have said when somebody saw him putting the figures in to a bass line. You know, he said, I'm doing that per le cane, doing that for the dogs. In other words, doing that for the idiots who can't figure out the harmony just by looking at the bass line. So Respighi puts a recording of the nightingale in so that le cane can say, that's not a nightingale, that's a violin. That kind of literalism is just, you know, against the whole principle of artistic representation. But it still leaves us with the question, why did Messiaen make such an issue out of claiming authenticity and accuracy when we know that he couldn't achieve it and we can hear that he didn't? All we do get is a kind of vague gestural similarity. he talked about this problem. He talked about, because he loved to talk about technique, Messiaen. He talked about the technique of transcribing bird calls. And he said, well, you gotta do several things. First of all, you have to expand all of the intervals. So if the actual bird interval is one or two commas, and he's using the word comma, that's Greek, you know, for a gap, and it's the gap between the octave as a 2-to-1 harmonic ratio and an octave which you achieve by going through 12 fifths. They don't end up being the same, although they ought to, but they don't. So that discrepancy is called the comma, and it's a very tiny interval. So Messiaen is using the term comma to mean anything below a semitone. So what is only a comma becomes a semitone, which means a semitone has to become a whole tone or perhaps a third. So he is expanding all the intervals. And then he says, and because the bird song is much too fast to play on most of our instruments or even to hear and parse, I slow everything down to half tempo or quarter tempo. Well, notice what he's doing. He's taking all the quantifiable aspects of the bird song, namely the pitch and the durations, and he is multiplying them all by a constant factor. You see, so you multiply all the pitches by 2, you multiply all the durations by 2, to take a simple case. That's applying an algorithm. That's why he was able to say that my bird songs are accurate. I'm extrapolating here, but it seems to me that's the only explanation that makes some sense to me. Because what you end up with, if you apply a constant factor, would be two versions which, as geometrists would say, they're similar in that all their proportions are the same, even though they're of different sizes, you see. So the contour, the melodic contour is conserved, even though the actual pitches may be different. And the sequence of events is conserved, and the relative durations, the rhythm is conserved, even though it all gets much longer. So it seems to me that that's the reason why Messiaen could go on saying that what he was doing was entirely authentic and accurate. And it's also the reason, it seems to me, why his music was, he was such an influential figure, and his music was so valued by composers who were not at all interested in bird calls and not at all interested in Catholic theology. You know, the fact that Messiaen became the great guru to the mid-century avant-garde, to Pierre Boulez and to Karlheinz Stockhausen and to George Ligeti and everybody, Bruno Maderna, Luciano Berio, they all revered Messiaen. Such an unlikely candidate to be the great hero of the avant-garde. He was an organist, a church organist, and he was a harmony teacher at the Paris Conservatoire. He wasn't even one of the big gun composers at the conservatory, yet everybody wanted to study with him. So they all took his analysis class, which turned into the chic composition class at the conservatory. And it's because Messiaen was interested in algorithms. He was interested in fully systematized technique. Even though he was applying those systems to a completely different end, for a completely different aesthetic purpose from what the serialist composers were doing. And Messiaen never wrote serial music and actually was just as skeptical of serial music as the people I've been quoting were skeptical of his bird song. He called serial music the international gray on gray. I love that expression, which shows, you know, that he understood that it takes out a lot of what he valued in music, namely color. But they loved Messiaen for his systematic teaching. He justified their systematic teaching with his own. All right, so still in all, we haven't answered the question, why birds? Messiaen gave several answers, and I'm an old Stravinsky hand. I've spent a lot of time working on Stravinsky, so I know you should never believe what a composer says. Because Stravinsky spent the second half of his very long life telling lies about the first half. And in doing that, he gave me my life's work, which has been devoted to correcting, you know, what Stravinsky had to say. But So I always take what composers themselves say with a grain of salt, and yet, even if what they're saying is not literally true, it's almost always gives you insight into their purposes and their values. So Messiaen said several things. One is, there's no contradiction between looking at birds and not being interested in the temporal world, because birds are not part of the temporal world. Birds are not culture, birds are nature. The world that Messiaen didn't pay attention to was the world of people, the social world, the historical world, the world of human time, yeah? Birds were put on earth by God himself. They are not creatures of God's creatures, they're creatures of God himself. So according to Messiaen, birds, and therefore by extension bird song, was primordial and eternal, like everything else that was of interest to Messiaen. Now, no ornithologist would agree with that. Ornithologists now tend to the opinion that bird song is learned behavior, not natural endowment. Just like our language is learned behavior, although we do have certain vocalizations we all make that may be instinctual. If you hurt us, we'll shout, and you tickle us, we'll laugh, and you know, it sounds like a Shylock in The Merchant of Venice. But if you do certain things to us, certain things happen vocally, involuntarily. Well, that kind of thing is also probably true of birds, ornithologists think. But birds learn their complicated songs by precept and imitation. And we know this must be true because we can observe what other things birds learn to imitate, like human speech. When parrots and minor birds imitate human speech, they don't know what they're saying. They're imitating the sounds that they hear. And one Australian ornithologist musician who likes to call herself a zoomusicologist, her name is Hollis Taylor. She said that when she also observes and transcribes bird song, and she wrote a fascinating article that appeared in a journal called 20th Century Music last year, in which she compared her transcriptions of certain Australian birds to Messiaen's from the same recordings. And again, Messiaen didn't admit that he was using the recordings, but she was able to determine that he was, the way Rob Fallon did in the case of the North American birds. She transcribes birdsong for herself to perform on violin, which means she, unlike Messiaen, is truly interested in transmitting the authentic and accurate birdsong. Messiaen only said he was, but she actually is trying to do it. And maybe that's the reason why we all know Messiaen's music and we have never heard Hollis Taylor's music. It probably has something to do with it. Because Hollis Taylor said, and this is one of these most sensible comments I've ever encountered, about Messiaen the ornithologist, that Messiaen's bird transcriptions are not real bird transcriptions. They're of no use at all to ornithologists, but they were of great use to him in composing because what they really are preliminary composition sketches. He's already composing when he's doing his bird transcription. Well, again, I say that's very sensible because what else would you expect a composer to do? And she said, what Messiaen does is conditioned by Messiaen's priorities, by Messiaen's cultural values, and by Messiaen's enculturation, as she puts it, like any other composers would be. This is the reason why Messiaen's birds sound like Messiaen and Wagner's sound like Wagner, right? We would expect that. And so what she's saying, very sensibly, by Messiaen is the very same thing that Jean-Jacques Cocteau once said in a book called Coque à la Cam, which I bet was not one of Messiaen's favorite books, but nevertheless, a very famous statement of Cocteau. An original composer, or an original artist, rather, not about composers only, but an original artist has but to copy in order to show his originality. That applies perfectly to Messiaen's very dogged attempts to render birdsong accurately. What you end up with is very original music. All right, so why birds? Here's another attempt Messiaen made to explain that. Am I running out of time? All right, so we may not get to most of the other examples, but I'll describe a few of them. Actually, you know what, John? Let's skip to the last two examples, and I'll need to say a few things first. The other thing Messiaen said about why he uses birds is that birds are the symbol of freedom. He said, we walk, it flies. We fight wars, it sings. Birds' disputes are settled with tournaments of song, you know, just like in Tannhäuser. But you know, it may be not a very accurate statement about birds, but it's a good statement about Messiaen's values having to do with freedom. This is where I think the Cold War comes into Messiaen's views about music. Because the change over from saying that it's senseless to try to imitate nature to claiming that he's doing that very thing happened at exactly the time when birds became very big in the visual arts, thanks to Pablo Picasso and his peace doves, you know, which he created at the request of Louis Aragon, who was an important writer and also one of the leaders of the French Communist Party, which Picasso had just joined, for peace propaganda. So this was just around the time when Messiaen began writing his big birdie pieces. So there may be some connection there. But actually, I think that to go back to the original use of birds in Messiaen applies to all the uses of birds in Messiaen. The first bird was the dove, right? Why the dove? Because we all know, do we not, that the dove was the iconographical embodiment of the Holy Spirit. The reason for it, I guess I don't have time for much in the way of theology. Not that I'm a particularly good source for theology, but I found this very interesting. The reason why the dove is associated with the Holy Spirit comes from a Babylonian Talmudic interpretation of the second verse of the first chapter of the book of Genesis. You all remember it, right? You all know the first verse. In the beginning, God created heaven, the heavens and the earth, right? What comes next? And the earth was without form and void, and the Spirit of God hovered over the waters. And the Babylonian Talmudist adds, like a dove. And that was the beginning of this iconographical tradition. And so, and the other iconographical tradition having to do with a dove goes back to the eighth chapter of the book of Genesis, which is the story of Noah, who, when he'd been for 40 days and 40 nights out on the water in his ark, sent out a dove, right? Sent out the dove three times. First time the dove comes back, and so Noah knows that it's not time yet to disembark. The third time, the dove doesn't come back at all, which means the dove has landed. So Noah decides it's time to disembark. But the second time, the dove comes back with an olive branch. And the olive branch therefore becomes the great symbol of reconciliation between God and man, and by extension, the symbol of peace. So these are all feeding into Messiaen's interest in doves, and hence birds, and being the great systematizer, the great cataloger. He wrote a big set of piano pieces called Catalogue d'Oiseaux, as you know. Big systematizer, encyclopedist. He decided, if I'm going to use doves, I'll use every bird. And he became terribly interested in what birds were saying, because, and here I could go back to the very first example I could find, won't have any time to play it for you, of bird song in art music. It's a 14th century dance song called a virelè, in which the bird is saying, well, you know the song The Red, Red Robin that was popular when I was a little boy, so that means it's a very old song. When the red, red robin comes bob, bob, bobbing along, what does it say? Wake up, you sleepyhead, get up, get out of bed. In French, the bird in the 14th century version of that song goes, katydidyu, 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 katydidyu. It's probably a bird that we would call in English a katydid from the sound of the bird call, but in French, katydidyu means what God is telling you, right? So the bird is the divine messenger. And what do we call a divine messenger? A divine messenger is a prophet. The idea of the bird as prophet is part of many folklore traditions as well as religions. And I would have jumped had I had time to Schumann's famous piano piece, Vogel als Prophet, from his Waldszenen or forest scenes. From there we go to Wagner, Siegfried, and his forest bird, who's telling Siegfried to watch out because Mima's going to kill him for the ring. So bird is telling him a message from, well, in this case, the gods, not from God, but the prophet bird. So I want to end with prophet birds that we don't know are prophet birds, just as a way of reminding us that we don't necessarily know all the things that Messiaen was trying to tell us in those bird choruses that he said were just birds. The fact that he said they were just birds doesn't mean a thing, because he's just saying what he wants, what he thinks the interviewer wants to hear. But here's a bunch of birds that I'm sure you'll recognize. This is number 30, yeah?
Yep.
Let's have number 30. That's a nightingale. Bum ba bum is the quail, and bum bum, you know who that is, right? That one's the same, no matter who's doing it. So we have the nightingale, the quail, and the cuckoo all singing. And for hundreds of years, people have just said, oh yeah, those are three very realistically portrayed birds. Well, not really realistically, but for Beethoven, realistically portrayed birds. But you know, it took a long time, but a musicologist friend of mine figured out what those birds are saying. The quail goes like this, dum ba dum, right? Bum ba dum, bum ba dum. The cuckoo goes bum bum, bum bum. So put the two of them together, bum ba dum bum, bum ba dum bum. Does that ring a Beethoven bell? Let's have number 31. Thank you, maestro. Yeah, the birds are singing Beethoven's Fifth. Now, let me just continue. This was a man named Owen Jander, one of the best musical hermeneuts there is. He reminds us, after noting that the birds are somehow singing Beethoven's Fifth in Beethoven's Sixth, reminds us that Beethoven's Fifth and Beethoven's Sixth were both given their premiere in one concert. One long concert that also had the premiere of the Fourth Piano Concerto. Huh? Hell of a concert. And the other thing that you have to remember is that the Sixth was played before the Fifth, and it was called the Fifth. And the Fifth was called the Sixth at that first concert. So first we hear bum, ba, bum, bum, and then we hear bum, ba, ba, bum, and a whole movement built on it. In fact, not just a whole movement, but a whole symphony built on it. So is there actually a connection, or is it just a coincidence? Well, I won't presume to say. Owen Jander says it is not a coincidence. Owen Jander actually presumed to say what the birds were saying to Beethoven. I won't go that far. You can go look it up. But birds are speaking to us in the world of romantic music, and I believe in the world of Messiaen, too. No matter what he said they were doing, he was probably hearing more in those bird calls than we'll ever hear, and than he ever wanted us to hear. Thank you very much.